document E319/19.320 at answer 57. Question. When you were a soldier, did your chief ever give you a list and order you to arrest anyone whose name was on the list? Answer. No, this work was carried out by militiamen. My unit did not do this work, but sometimes I received an order from the upper echelon to arrest someone who was on the run. Sometimes I managed to catch them, but other times they managed to escape. End of quote. And in your DC CAM interview, E3/9060, ERN Khmer 00733024, that's Khmer ERN 733024, English 00728726, and French 01123681. Question. So, as you were in the troops, your role was to guard and inspect the dam, checking if there was damage. Did you also guard against something else? Answer. Guard against everything. If they contacted us and we found people escaping, we would arrest them. Even after the arrest, we could not kill them. We arrested them and sent them over to the superiors to deal with them. End of quote. Mr. Witness, does that refresh your memory that while arrests were not your primary function, that there were some occasions where you and your unit were assigned and arrested workers who tried to escape from the site?
Was rearrested, then the person will be sent to his respective unit so that the unit chief would deal with him.
In the answers I read, you referred to receiving an order from the upper echelon to try to arrest someone who had escaped. When you referred to upper echelon, who was it specifically that the orders came from down to your unit? Who was it that provided those orders? Specifically, when those workers were caught, who were they turned over to? You've said that they were turned over to the upper echelon or your superiors. Specifically, who would those workers be turned over to?
The man or the person would be given back to the chief of the unit or the chief of the regiment.
Were you aware, Mr. Witness, of any instances where workers were killed at the Trapyang Tama Dam worksite? report, please, what happened to workers at the Trapyang Tama Dam who said they could not work at night because of night blindness. Can you please tell the court what happened to those people?
I heard from workers in the mobile unit, for those who had night blindness, some of them actually did not have night blindness, so they made a test of them. They were instructed to walk toward a pit, and if they actually avoid the pit, then they would be accused of pretending to have night blindness, and they would be arrested.
I'd like to you to refer to, if you could, your OCIJ interview, E3-9060. I'm sorry, yeah, your DC CAM interview, E3-9060. The ERN references Khmer 00733020 through 021, English 00728724, French 0112-3679 through 3680. And I quote your statement in your DC CAM interview, quote, "When one was having night blindness, the person was accused of having consciousness blindness. The big or small unit of which that person was a member transported the person to the pits. If the person avoided the pits, they would say that the person did not have night blindness. Those pits, it would result in death if you fell into them." And continuing below on the same page, "If the person was led to a pit and avoided the pit, the accompanying person would push that person into the pit. Question, did you witness the event? Answer, I saw it. Because it had nothing to do with the troops, they did the work amongst themselves. The killings of people were not done by troops, but by the chief of battalion, regiment, and company." End of quote. Mr. Witness, is it correct, as you told DC CAM, that you witnessed these events?
They did what they had to do. President and Defense Counsel, Constable On, you have the floor. Constable On, thank you, Mr. President. I'd like to make my remark on the extract by the co-prosecutor. In the Khmer version, the witness did not state that falling into the pit would result in death. And it referred to those who avoided the pit, then the person would be pushed into the pit.
Thank you, counsel. I read the English translation. I don't understand the inconsistency between them. Mr. Witness, let me ask you about these pits. Where were the pits located at the work site, and how deep were they?
Was not far from where they got the dirt for the dam site, and the depth was about 1 meter.
someone would push them into that, into the pit. Is that correct? Did you see that happen?
Yes, I saw it. People who had this psychological sickness, and if they avoided the pit and they were pushed into the pit, and they might have a joint dislocation or swollen ankle. And for people who were found out to lie to have lied to them, they will be re-educated or reprimanded, but falling into the pit did not result in death, but injury.
Do you know?
President, Defense Counsel Copper, do you have the floor?
Thank you, Mr. President. I would like to make an observation as following up on the observation or objection from my colleague from the Houston Panty. If, I mean, indeed, in the English version, I agree with the prosecution. It says those pits, it would result in death if you fell into them. Now, if that sentence doesn't appear in the original command version, I find that quite troubling. So I would be really interested, and considering the evidence just given by the witness that it is only a pit of 1 meter and that your ankle would get swollen, I think this is a difference that I would like to have cleared when it comes to translation. So the request really is, what does the original command version say? Does it say something to the effect it would result in death if you fell into them?
The parties are certainly able to pursue this and review the Khmer original. It's not something I can do standing here now. Let's revisit this after people who can interpret and translate.
President, actually we have the witness here before us, and you can clarify the matter with him, co-prosecutor.
I will clarify with the witness, but the issue about the transcript I think is something that will have to be dealt with later by people who can review the original Khmer transcript. Mr. Witness, we want to make sure this is clear. The people who avoided the pits and were pushed into them, did any of them die, to your knowledge?
To my knowledge, none of them died. They wanted to know whether those workers pretended to be sick in order to avoid going to work by telling them that they had night of blindness. For that reason, those people were led into walking into the pits, and if they actually fell into the pits, then they would be allowed to rest at night. However, for those who did not fall into the pits, they would be accused of pretending to be sick, and then they would be reprimanded or criticized. And if after one or two occasions they still repeat this imaginary sickness, then they will be taken away and killed.
Let's start first of all with people who actually did have night blindness and who were forced to walk and fell into these pits. Were any of them injured as a result of being forced to walk into the pits at nighttime when they couldn't see?
Who actually had night blindness, they were about to step into the pits, but they were stopped by the people at the pit, and they knew that these people or these workers actually had night blindness. However, for other workers who pretended to have night blindness, they would step away. away from the pit, and then they would be called for the education, as actually they pretended to have night blindness.
And for the people who were determined to be pretending and who were sent for re-education, do you know what happened to them after they were sent for re-education, or were you not involved in the process?
Of the mobile units, those people would be criticized and they had to be refashioned and they had to stop lying through the unit chiefs again.
And what about people who couldn't be refashioned, Mr. Witness? What happened to them? Chiefs dealt with situations like that?
The solution was to kill that worker.
Mr. Witness, did you know of any locations at or near the Trapyang Tama site where people were taken for execution?
Regarding the Trapyang Tama Dam and its vicinity, I never heard of the center.
Was there a security center in Phnom Srok district?
There was a district security center at Phnom Srok district.
And was there a sector security office? And if so, where was the sector security office located?
As for the sector security office, it was located at the current district office. And in fact, it was a concrete house which turned into a security center and which is currently the district office.
Just to clarify, Mr. Witness, the location you're just talking about, the concrete house that is at the current location of a district office, are you talking about where the location of the Phnom Srok security office? Or was that the Sector 5 security office? Could you clarify that?
The Phnom Srok security office belongs to the Phnom Srok district. As for the Sector 5 security office, it was located in Swai.
questions about the conditions at Trapiang Tama. Starting with work hours at the site, can you tell us what the work hours were during the time you were at the Trapiang Tama Dam work site? Clarify something with you. In your OCIJ interview, E319/19.3.20 at answer 81, you indicated that work started at 6 a.m. Just now you said 7 a.m. Can you give us your best recollection? Was it 6 a.m. or 7 a.m. that workers started working at Trapiang Tama? In regards to work during nighttime, how often did people have to work at nighttime while you were at Trapiang Tama? Was it every night or was it only some nights?
Every day until the dam project was completed.
What can you tell us about the food rations and work quotas at the Trapiang Tama Dam worksite? And did you know what the, if those workers had a work quota in terms of the amount of dirt they had to dig and carry each day? CAM interview, Mr. Witness, you referred to there being what you called special units that had different quotas and different food rations than the regular workers. Can you explain to the court what these special units were? 728-716 through 717, and French 0112-3673. I quote, members of special units were given 2 cans of rice each day. Members of on-foot units were given 1 can of rice each day. Special units would carry 1 cubic meter of earth in 8 carrying trips. Women were even running while carrying the baskets back and forth. These were the special units. End of quote. I want to make sure I understand correctly. Are you saying that these special units received higher food rations and had to perform more work, or do I not understand, or is that incorrect? Can you clarify, were these special units units that had higher work quotas and received greater food rations? Is that right?
Unit workers work more progressively, so the food ration was more than the ordinary mobile unit workers. And in terms of clothing, then they had better clothing to wear than the ordinary barefoot mobile unit workers. And they were an exemplary model for the mobile units.
And how many workers at Trapping Tama were in such a special unit that received a larger amount of food and more progressive work assignments?
In the special unit, they actually had a force of workers of a size of a regiment. They were female youth.
This unit of female youth that you referred to as a special unit, how many females were in this unit?
In that unit, there were women in 2 big units, and there were male youths in another unit. And they were the absolute force, and they were selected to be part of this so-called special unit.
Let me read to you another excerpt from your DC CAM interview, E3/9060. This is at Khmer 00733030, English 00728730, French 0112-3684 through 85. I quote, the special unit was composed of only 100 members. The rest were normal mobile units, which were estimated in the tens of thousands. 4 to 5 persons of the normal mobile unit carried 1 cubic meter of earth, and they had small rations. And continuing below on the same page, question. So the remaining tens of thousands of other people were given only 1 can of rice per day? Answer, yes, 1 can per day, end of quote. Does this refresh your recollection, Mr. Witness, that the special unit that you've described only had 100 members? Is that correct?
the special unit, there were female members who served in the special unit. And they were entitled to one can of rice per day as for the food ration for them.
Where did the people at the Trapiang Tama Dam site get water to drink?
They carry the water for us to drink. There were a group of laborers who brought the water for us to drink. And other members also carry the water from the nearby ponds and stream to drink.
Mr. Witness, did people at the Trapiang Tama site get sick often? What did you observe while you were there in terms of the health of the workers at the site?
The workers at Trapiang Tama site, there were many people who were sick. Some were poisoned by the eating wild plants or wild mushroom, and they also suffer from many different kinds of diseases. Some had their body, you know, swollen body.
Let me refer you to, again, your DC CAM interview, E3/9060, Khmer ERN 00733030331, English 00728731, French 01123685. I quote, Mr. Witness, this is what you said to DC CAM, quote, "People were emaciated without enough food to eat. Lack of nutrition led to exhaustion. For some, their knees were bigger than their heads," end of quote. Mr. Witness, was this the case during the entire time you were at the Trapiang Tama worksite?
Yes. It was the case. At the times, those who were skinny, they did not have sufficient food to eat, and some had to do overwork, and they were not given enough food, so they became very thin and weak. And of course, others, you know, had their knee bigger than their heads. They ask for medicine when they were sick, but they were given nothing more than the rabbit drop pill.
Thank you, Mr. Witness. I want to ask you also about the hygiene at the work site. Can you tell us where did people go to relieve themselves? Were there latrines, or where was it that people would have to go to relieve themselves?
At the time, the upper echelon constructed the latrine for us in the different units so that we could relieve ourselves. And but anyway, it was not enough. mosquitoes. At night, if we did not have mosquito net, we were, you know, lots of mosquitoes bit us. And in the morning, we had to get up early in order to go to work.
I want to turn to another subject for the time we have left today. Do you remember a period when the local cadres in the Northwest Zone were arrested and replaced by cadres who came from the Southwest? Do you remember that? And what can you tell us about what happened to the Northwest Zone cadres at that time?
At the time when I was working at the Tupang Tumor Construction Dam, I heard the upper echelon. They told me that they would arrest the Northwest Zone cadres, and they summoned them for the meeting, and the cadres from the Southwest Zone carried out the arrest. They accused them of betraying.
When you say that you were told by the upper echelon that they were going to arrest the cadres, who was it that told you this? Who do you mean by the upper echelon?
Tana was my superior, and he knew that, and he told to his subordinates that we had to be extra vigilant in our work. And then later on, the Southwest Zone cadres came to the Northwest Zone.
And you said that when people were arrested, they were called to attend meetings or study sessions. Can you tell us how it was, how it happened when people were called to these study sessions? Who would tell them that they had to go, and where was it that they were told to go?
I did not know the details of how it was carried out, but I only heard from others that they were summoned to attend the meeting or study session, and then they disappeared ever since.
Let me read to you an excerpt from your DC CAM interview, E3/9060. This is at Khmer 00733047, English 00728742-743, and French 01123695. Quote, let me repeat the Khmer ERN. It is 00733047. This is what you said, Mr. Witness. Quote, those Southwesterners did not even bother to point a gun at us. They would call us to have a chat. Then they told us to go up to the concrete house, and they arrested us. They put us in a truck and sent us to the secret place at Svai Sisapon, the police station of Mr. Lon. End of quote. And Mr. Witness, who was this person, Mr. Lon, and what was the police station that he had responsibility for in Sisapon? Northwest Zone cadres identified in your interviews and what happened to them during this period. First of all, you identify a person named Ta Hung. Who was Ta Hung and what happened to him at or around the time the Southwest cadres arrived in your region?
Upon the arrival of the Southwest Zone cadres, they called for a meeting. And Ta Hung was arrested. And from that time onward, people knew that the Northwest Zone cadres were arrested by the Southwest Zone.
What was Ta Hung's position?
He was the chief of Sector 5.
Did you know a cadre named Ta Mang from Pray Net Pray? And can you tell us what happened to him when the Southwest cadres arrived?
When the Southwest Zone arrived, Ta Mang was also convened to a meeting, and at that time he was arrested.
We've talked a little today already about Taval, the Sector 5 mobile work chairman who supervised the trapping Tamad Dam. What happened to Taval when the Southwest cadres arrived?
The president, counsel, you have the floor. You may proceed.
Thank you, Mr. President. I have some trouble with the way this question is formulated. When the Southwest Zone cadres arrived, it was fine in respect of the first two Northwest Zone cadres. But the next one that we're discussing, I think the prosecution will agree, was arrested 4 months later, 3 months later. And the last Northwest Zone cadre was arrested a year later. So just saying that there is a wave of arrest the moment that the Southwest Zone cadres arrived is simply incorrect.
Mr. President, counsel is not here to give evidence. I can assure him from the S21 records that he's wrong. There was a wave of arrests. It's documented in the records of S21. I'm actually going to make some references to try to refresh memory on dates, so I will get to some of those S21 records. In the meantime, I'm asking the witness simply what happened when the Southwest cadres arrived and getting his recollection. Then we'll take a look at the S21 records to see when this took place. So if I may proceed, the question I'd like to ask the witness now is, what happened to Taval after the Southwest cadres arrived? With your leave, Mr. President.
Yes, you may proceed, prosecutor.
What happened to Taval, Mr. Witness?
After Ta Mang was arrested, he disappeared ever since. Then for about around 10 days or so, they arrested Taval. They called him for a meeting. it with me at the construction site. He told me that they had arrested all the cadres in the northwest zone, and that arrest was carried out by the southwest cadres.
And the last person I wanted to ask you about was Tahat. Who was Tahat, and what happened to him after the Southwest cadres arrived?
After the Southwest zone cadres arrived, Tahat also was called to attend a meeting at SPY.
Do you remember the year and month when Ta Hung, Ta Mang, Ta Val, and Ta Hat were arrested? Are you able to tell us what year and month that took place?
To the best of my recollection, it was about at the beginning of the year, and toward the end of the year, we attained peace.
Let me see if I can refresh your memory on this, Mr. Witness. There are a number of surviving records relating to these people. First of all, document E3/1181, E3/1181, is a report titled General View of Sector 5. It's dated 27 June 1977, and it records that the Sector 5 Secretary Hung had been arrested as of that date, as of June 1977. We have a document, E3/1900. It is an S21 prisoner list titled Names of Prisoners Smashed on the 6th of March, 1978. Number 12 on that list is...
President, Council, you may proceed.
Yes, it does. We have different information when it comes to Men Chun alias Hung. He was arrested in February 77.
I'd be curious to the site. There's multiple documents that establish it was June 1977, including a reference in his S21 confession that specifically gives a specific date in June also. In any event, if you have a document, you're entitled to ask the witness about it during your examination. Mr. President, may I proceed?
President, Judge Levenge, you may proceed now.
Council Coppe, could you please give us the references of the document that you were referring to? Thank you.
If you allow me to do that, not just now, but tomorrow morning early.
Continue. In addition to the document relating to Sector 5 Secretary Hung, E3-1900 records that an Auk Hon alias Val, identified as an assistant to Sector 5, entered S21 on 77, and in regards to Pre Net Pre, District Secretary On Mung, E3342, the OCP revised S21 prisoner list. Number 57 on that list records that Mung entered S21 on the 28th of June, 1977. We have three documents that is all have dates, the 27th, the 28th, and the 29th of June, 1977. Mr. Witness, I realize this was a long time ago. Does that refresh your recollection that these arrests took place some point in mid-1977, possibly in June of that year?
At the time, I was very young, but the arrest was carried out quite close to one another, actually. They arrested, first of all, Taval, and then followed by others. And they intended, actually, to arrest all the cadres at the time.
You've talked about Deputy Commander Ta Nak from Phnom Srok District Military. What happened to Ta Nak?
Then Ta Nak will also call for the study session. And as his subordinate, I knew that he would be arrested if he went there. And then he did not listen to me. And he went to attend the meeting, but then I did not see him return. And then his wife told everyone that Tana had already been arrested.
Mr. Witness, was there a time that the
President, Council Consumon, you may proceed. Council Consumon, thank you, Mr. President. I would like to request that the co-prosecutor make reference to a document E3/19100. It seems to me that this document doesn't appear in the case file, so could you please ask the prosecutor to verify this? The President, Mr. Prosecutor, can you please verify this document reference?
Yes, I think he's referring to something from 5 or 5 minutes ago, but the document is E3/1900. Mr. Witness, my next question is about yourself. Was there any time where the Southwest Cadres tried to arrest you? And if so, can you tell the court what happened?
After they arrested all cadres, we all separated. I fled to my house, and then the Southwest cadre arrested me. And then I tried to escape eventually, and luckily I could escape.
Where were you taken when you were arrested?
Buddhist commune.
How was it that you were able to escape?
At that time, I used Khmer traditional martial arts, and I knocked down the security guards over there, and then I fled the scene.
And my last question today, Mr. Witness, before we break. After the arrests of your commander, Nak and Chun, what happened to your military unit after your commanders were arrested?
After my superior were arrested, they accused our village as the traitors. So they suspected us of being traitors. They intended to arrest all of us, and then we had to took refuge in the jungle. At that time, we fled into the forest.
President, I can continue with questions if you wish me to go on. I see we're at 4 o'clock.
Thank you, Mr. Prosecutor. The time is now appropriate for the adjournment. The chamber shall adjourn now, and we will resume tomorrow on Wednesday, the 12th. Of August 2015, starting at 9 a.m. The chamber would continue to hear the witness, Lord Sui, and we will summon another TCW 937. And I ask members and relevant parties to be present tomorrow morning. And Mr. Lon Sui, for your information, your testimony has not yet been concluded, so I invite you to come to testify here before the chamber again tomorrow. Court officers are instructed now to coordinate with the Waisu to assist the transportation of Mr. Lon Sui to his place and have him back in this courtroom on Wednesday, the 12th of August 2015, before 9 a.m. Security guards are instructed to bring the two co-accused, Mr. Nguyen Chi and Mr. Kieu Sun Phorn, back to the detention facility and have them back in the hearing on the 12th of August 2015, before 9 a.m. The court is now adjourned.